Did everybody get the chance to submit their assignment one?
Yep, several times. CC this person now.
Yeah. All right, wonderful. We'll put next to your name links to all of your submissions. So somebody wanted to see other submissions, so you will see that. So today we are going to talk about XML. XML is very critical. As I was mentioning in my first class, while HTML was designed for human consumption, much of the data that flows on the web and that is used by the application is not for human consumption, or is not immediately coming to humans. It's processed internally, exchanged between the applications, and I'm guessing, right? Wild guess is that compared to the HTML that actually gets displayed, XML probably is an order of magnitude a larger content, if not much more than that, behind the scenes, right? So, as a computer scientist, you're going to write applications that process the data as it flows on the web. So, it's almost inconceivable to think about developing significant web applications that does not somehow involve XML. And so it is very critical that we learn about XML, how do we process them. And so Sujan is going to cover that today and Thursday, and we will have assignment on Thursday based on XML.
Hi guys, I'm Sujan.
Hello.
I'll be talking about XML and its components like HSP, and XSL, and we'll be talking about parsers, XML parsers. So for this class, I'll be assuming that you know HTML and Java, right? Not in deep, but you can understand simple Java code that won't be. And then these slides are basically based on W3C school site. And I will be posting these slides and the video immediately after the class. And assignment based on XML, SSD, and all related components will be given on Thursday, which will cover almost every component of this. Okay, let's get started. So I hope that everybody, at least in once you heard about XML, that at least the term XML, even though you didn't use it extensively for applications, but people use it extensively for a lot of things. Like it has various purposes, mainly for data exchange, where you can have a common agreement saying that I am sending this information in this format, and somebody can receive that and process it because you have the agreement between it. And then people use it for store the data, but it's going to be a file-based part. You can store almost anything, but it's going to be a file-based one. And then this XML language is very flexible. It does not have a predefined tags like HTML, where you have p tags, various other tags like headers and everything, table and everything. But XML is not something like that. You can define your own tags, which make the XML, the data of XML, self-describing. We will see some examples so that you will understand what it is. And so people use this XML language to build their own languages for their own applications. So some of the well-defined things are WSDL, which is a web service description language. Actually, lot of technologies, lot of components of web services are based on XML. And then this is RDF. You may have heard about that. Now it's getting very popular. Resource description framework, where you specify things in XML format. And then RSS, again, feed language. So this is just three. But if you browse through the web, you will find ton of these kind of things where people have defined their own things and use it for their domain specific things. And even though you can do a lot of things with XML, it's not difficult to learn these things. XML is not a very difficult language. It's just a markup language. I'm not saying it's a markup language, but you can do a lot of things, but it's easy to learn. And as a computer undergrad, computer science undergrad, computer engineering undergrad, you must learn it. Okay, so if you have to do with something with XML, you might find these two things handy also. So one is HSL, it is extensible style sheet language, where you use this language to display the XML, whatever the data you represent in XML. You can display your data as you like. Like you can convert your XML to HTML with all these nice things. And then to have the agreement between two parties, like the sender and receiver. So if I'm agreed to, I'm supposed to send you a message with XML, you and me should agree with the format. So how do you define this format? How do you define this agreement? The protocol is by using something called XSD, which is stand for XML schema definition. Yeah, you can have the restrictions, yeah, you can have the data types, and all those things. So we'll be covering these two components most probably on Thursday. So today we are going to focus on XML, the core language. So let's have a glimpse about what is XML document is. So here you will get, you will find all major attributes of XML document. Now, it starts with something called processing instruction. This processing instruction is for the XML parser. So we will see what is XML parser, and I will be demonstrating you guys what is the XML parser. And so here, this is a comment, you know, what's comment is, right? Even in any programming language, you will find the comment where you can describe what we are doing here in plain English. So this statement will not be processed by the parser. It just ignore it. And then you will, each and every XML document should be something for root element. Here it is the not. Okay. So every XML tag should be crossed by corresponding tag. Where you have the forward slash. The beginning. So, and then you can have your own tags in here. Like in HTML, you cannot do like this. Not to from. Okay. So these are defined tags, defined by me, defined by somebody who written this, and it is self-describing. Say that to this guy from this guy, and what is this, and what is this about? So you can do these kind of things. We call this element, okay? And then we call these things, like here you can see this is the data which is in between the element. This is not the data which is inside the element. What we call is the attribute. So all the metadata, normally what we do is all the meta, yeah.
So far this is very similar to HTML and CSS. So what's really the difference between these two besides? So far the program looks very similar, it's only for a few changes in the name and such.
Yes, so the basic difference is the purpose. XML, HTML is for display the data. Yeah, you like the what Dr. mentioned, like to human readable. So every browser will know how to display the HTML document because it has all these predefined tags, and this the how to display these tags is pre-agreed. So that is why you can build browsers on top of HTML, but you cannot do it with XML because you can write your XML document, I can write my XML document, but how come Google Chrome know how to interpret your one and mine? Got it? The main use of attributes is to describe the data, like the what we call the metadata. Right? You are here. The data is about some amount. Okay? You say you are describing about some component, and this is the price. And you say it is 20. Okay? And you need to say that it is United States dollars. Okay, USD. So you can say here you describe this 20 by saying that it is USD. If you have samples. So here you get all the four major components of XML document. There are two terms where you call XML document should be well formed and valid. What does it mean? Is well formed means, as I said, every XML document should have one root element, okay, which wraps all other tags with one thing. In the previous XML document, you can see two from heading and body tags is been wrapped by the tag not. Sorry, not. Okay. So that's what we call the root tag. And all tags should have corresponding end tag. So here you see, here you start the element tag and you close the tag. So every tag should have its corresponding end tag. And then tags should never be overlapped. Like if you start with author and you describe the name, you should close the name first, not the author. So this is wrong. Here author, name, and this should be name, and then the author. Okay. So if you nest the tags, you should be careful about closing the tags. And attributes must be ordered. Like you should have with the double quote or the single. That is about well formedness of XML document. The validness of the XML documents is.
Well, could we do author name, then name, author, basically keeping them in different parentheses, as long as author begins and ends after name is already beginning, begin and ended, would it work that way? Could we just.
Yeah, as long as you end the name tag before the author tag, you're fine. So validity of the XML documents always adapts with the schema. Like what I said, like XSD, which we use to describe the schema of the XML document, validness we define with that. Like if I send you the message which is not valid with the XSD, then it's not valid. So there are a few attributes about the XML document. So basically XML document is a tree structure. Okay. Yeah, you have the root and then the children, and then you can have a children again and same things like that. So basically when we process the XML document, basically you are processing a tree. Okay. And then tags are So So tags are case sensitive. So this name is different from that name. So if you start the tag with the lowercase name and end with uppercase name, then it is not performed. And then as I described earlier, you can have the comments. Here I start with angle brackets and exclamation and then hyphen and close it like this. And XML elements, if you talk about XML elements, it can contain other elements and it can contain text, other data, and then element can contain attributes. Okay, so we saw that in the previous document. And valid names for the elements, you can have all the characters, but you cannot start things with special characters. But you can have underscores and numbers and special characters in between of the. These are basically generic things because here you get the space between two terms. So XML elements and attributes. So here you can see this is what we call the data where you start with the tag and end with the tag, and in between that you get the data. And attributes is about something like this, where you can define an image. Okay, so this is the name of the image and you are saying that's the type of like that. You describe your data using the attributes, which is called the metadata. That's the difference between XML elements and XML attributes. Sometimes people use these things interchangeably, like you can have the image, name, and there's another tag describing the type is GIF, something like that also. But the standard way of using the attributes is to describe the data which is being nested by the tags.
Does it ever show up on the HTML when it's transferred to the page, or is that just an internal description?
The purpose of this is for internal things, but once you pass the XML document, you can get these things get this attribute and get these things like that. But this is basically to it's not for display purpose. So here you saw in my XML document, it had this processing instruction say that this document is from XML version 1.0. So they have these different formats, different versions, standard versions. We have 1.0 and 1.1, but if you are dealing with English documents, doesn't matter. You can use 1.0 without any problem. The 1.1 is, so here they are talking about the names of the tags. Okay. In 1.0, everything not permitted, like this start from 2, start from dollar sign, those are not permitted, right? It's forbidden. Like you cannot use it. But in 1.1, everything is not found, not forbidden. You can use it. Okay? So the main reason to do this thing is, Unicode is expanded, right? You cannot have this set you cannot use this. What you can say is, this set is not permitted, but everything else will be, you can use it. Okay? So here, if you take one XML 1.1 document, it is not compatible with 1.0 passes because it will have more characters. But if you take this document, you can pass it with 1.1. The main reason is, even though it is, does not have this issue, but other languages will have these special characters and all those things. They cannot have a specific set of things that say that this is not allowed. So they do it in other way. But, yes.
I want to try and say this. 1.0 is compatible with 1.1 because we can pass stuff from 1.0 to 1.1.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. But we can't pass stuff from 1.1 to 1.0.
No. Yes. Okay. So there are two terms saying that forward compatible and backward compatible. Okay. So if 1.1 can be passed with 1.0, what we call is backward compatible. Okay. But here it's not the case. Here, 1.0, you cannot pass 1.1 document to 1.0. So it is not backward compatible. Here what we call is forward compatible. So, okay, now imagine that everybody using XML documents and they are describing their own things using XML documents and XML elements and all these things. So I'm using a file in terms of there are two types of files where I need to describe file in hardware and somebody need to describe file in office. So you use the same term called the file. Okay, but you mean two different things. I mean some on hardware and somebody else mean file in office. But when it comes to when you try to integrate these things, it doesn't work because you don't know what I mean by file and the vice versa. So how do you differentiate these things like that? So the answer is, you have to use something called XML namespaces where you can define this file different from that file. Okay. How do you do that? It's like this. So here this file, the tag file, comes under this namespace. So the actual element, actual tag name would be like this and file. Okay. So you are not using just the file, but it is being distinguished by two different URIs. Yes.
So basically we're naming them both file X and int, because they're really good signs for places. We're also distinguishing under whatever number or letter in front of them.
So I didn't know.
Well, not only are we distinguishing them by where we're sending them to, but one's going to hardware, one's going to office. What about the letters in front of them? Is that also used to distinguish them, or is that just something else? Like H and O, are those also used as distinguishing?
This H?
Yeah.
H. Actually, this is a predefined XML. XML has just few predefined tags. So here what I'm saying is XML namespace. It is been H. I use it for. I don't want to say that. I don't want to replace this H with this one so that the document become not readable. So what I'm using is just this URL. This I'm using this H symbol to represent this URL. Okay. So actually, this file, the file element, would be that URL. Second file is going to be Okay? So that XML processor, XML parser, will know that this file is different from that file. So each and every H here, you can replace with this URL, but normally people, what they do is you define this XML NS, XML namespace somewhere in the document and use some symbol to represent this XML namespace in every IS.
Because it's making it easier to access that.
So here, I have defined this XML namespace inside the tag, okay? But what you can do is, at the top of the XML document, you can define all the namespaces you are going to use within the document. Okay. Let it be 100 or 200, whatever it is. You just define all these things with a preferred symbol, and then you use that symbol in the latter part of the document. So now that because this is different from that one, you can have different elements for describe whatever you meant to describe in the document. So you can have two different file tags in the same document also, same XML document, but still you are distinguished between these two. This is a file in somewhere else, this is the file in somewhere else. Okay, this is the most important part of this thing. What we have been discussing is how to define how to use the XML documents, how to define those things, and what are the good practices to do, define the XML, use the XML document. So, but XML are not meant to read by or used by humans. It's meant to use by or process by or whatever it is by the machines. So, but how do you do that? So, machine, if you use XML as storage medium, then machine should have a way to read these things. Like this is the tag name, this is the data of that tag, and these are the attributes of that tag, like that. So we have to have some way to do this. If you are using XML documents for even for displaying your data, there should be some way to say that to you, to say that browser, okay, display these things in this format, like that. Okay. So XML parsers, that's what we're gonna cover next. We will write the XML parsers to read the data from the XML documents. So I'll be using Java here, Java code. So we will be writing programs to parse the XML documents. So in this class, I'll be using Java. Java has three ways to parse a XML document. You can use, depending on your requirement, depending on your various other factors like the memory available and how critical the application and all these things, you can pick and choose between these three. Okay. So one is a SACS parser, simple API for XML, and then you will call the DOM, and then SPACS. So this is kind of a common thing, and people use that extensively, even the SACS also. But each and every way of Java will have its own advantages and disadvantages. So we'll be using, I'll be demonstrating you guys the code, how to pass the XML document in DOM way, SACS way, or this way in Java. Okay, so SACS stand for simple API for XML, DOM stand for document object model. This one stand for streaming API for XML. I would say these two things sex and dom are in two different extremes. This one kind of middle. Okay? So how we will see? This is the document that we're gonna pass, and we're gonna get the data out of this document. Okay? Just have a snap, just have a quick look on XML, and just have some picture in your mind. So when you go to the Java code, you will understand this is what's happening. Okay? So here you have the XML processing instruction, okay? And then my root tag is breakfast menu. And then I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, I think it's 5 only. 5 food tags. And name, price, description, and calories are being nested by the food tags. So these elements are under food. Because element can have elements, attributes, and data. Okay? So you can see. You have the name as a data and price, and the unit of price being described as an attribute, and you have more data about this description and calories. So we have 5 food tags for our menu. So let's try to have a. So I said that XML document is basically a system. Let's try to visualize what this document. So the root tag is breakfast menu.
So it's some kind of menu at a restaurant.
Sorry?
Basically looking at a menu from a restaurant.
Yes. Okay, so this is our root tag. Is this clear to the or the back? You guys can see this. You need to write in letters. How about you? Fine? Okay, this is our root tag. Food is under breakfast. So you have 5 food tags. Under breakfast, so we will be just drawing the tree. I'm not going to represent all these 5 food tags. So what we have is you have food tag under breakfast menu, and then all these things, name, price, description, and calories are under food. So we're going to pass this document using all the ways that Java has. Okay? So let's have a look at how DOM parser looks like.
Control plus.
New search.
think if you go to window,
window,
properties, the preferences,
yeah,
and then general.
Can you close it?
No,
just type in the search filter right there in the top of the chat box.
It's under style. Yeah, you need.
Do you know in Eclipse how do you increase the process?
I think so. I think so.
API, you basically you have to have this tree structure in your mind. Okay, so you get root element and dot get child. And if you if I'm talking about in terms of Java, like dot means to call that. Okay, so basically I'm saying this is my XML document that I showed you earlier. Okay, and I'm saying that okay, I need a document build factory, which is the DOM factory. Okay. If you don't understand each line and line by line, avoid it. Okay. So you will get all these samples in the group, and you can try on your own. Okay. And you have to do something like this in the sun. So you will be very comfortable with these things within few weeks. So. So here I am saying that my document is the this file, okay, and then basically what I can do is by giving the name, the element name, I can get the all elements of that. So like that, like this. Here I have the document. I can say get elements by tag name food. So it will give me all these five tags as a list, okay? So you can iterate through this list and you will get each and every food tag Yeah, you have the name, price, description, and headings. And then what you have to do is, so I will get all these elements one by one. Okay. So here, when they define the XML document in Java, they have a set of types for each and element, each and every element. They have an element node, they have attribute, they have data, C data, and all those things. So you will be familiarized with these things. So here, this contains of all the five tags. Okay. So and then what I'm doing is I'm iterating through these tags and get one by one, okay, and try to get the data out of the tag. So here, this is the element, okay, and then here you need to see the here, what I'm saying is, I'm just giving the next tag, okay, and the element. So here, basically, I'm using these tag names, but you can do without using the tag names also. Okay. Basically, what you can do is, you can get the root element, okay, and then you can say, and something like this. So it will give you all the elements. You don't have to hardcode these names. Okay. Like that, you can traverse through this all documents and get the tags also. So here, what I'm doing here is I'm giving the element and the tag name. Okay. And again, I'm using get elements by tag name here. This would be the first parameter, which is the five tags. Okay, and then always when you say get tag by name, even though there is only one, it will give you the list. Okay, because this API requires a generic tag. Okay, so there can be multiple tags, like what we have in food. But if you go into food, you will have only one name, but doesn't matter, it will give you the list. So you will get the list, and you know that I have only one name tag. So what you do is, give me the zeroth element of my list, which is the first element, which is the only element. And then you can say get not value. Like that. Likewise, you can get not value means the data within that element. So 1, 2, 3, 4. That for get tag value, this calls is for high level element. Okay. But how do you get the attributes of the element? Okay. So I have a different method down here to get attribute value. What I'm saying here is, I know that there's attribute called unit in the price. Please give me that. Okay. So how do I do that? Is by something like this. Okay. This is price, unit, and that element. Okay. So you can still get tag. This is the price tag. Okay. And you know only one price tag is there, and you get the zero element of that list. Okay. And then you say, give me all the attributes. Okay. And then you can, the attributes will be written as map. Okay. If you heard about maps in Java, okay. They're basically key value things. So by using this map and using your attribute name, you can say, give me the value of that. So basically, that attribute list will be written to you as a map, where you have key and the value. Okay. So this would be unit, and that key is key. So what you can say is, on top of this data structure, you can say, I know that something called unit in the map, give me the value of that item. Okay, or map, get name item, attribute name, and the value. Okay, so like that, you can process your XML document. You can, when you write, even though you didn't get with this code, when you write the XML document, you will, when you write the XML passes only on using DOM passes, you will see that you have to have some idea about the tree structure of the XML document. Because you have to say get child, and you have to know that these are the childs, and you have to know where the attributes are, and all. If you are just getting everything out of XML document, it doesn't matter much, because once you said that get children, and it will return you all the elements. If you don't want to filter out any elements, doesn't matter. But if you are pick and if you are doing some pick and choose in XML document, then you have to have that tree structure, and you have to know that these are the elements where you have the attributes. These are the things that I need to pick out from the XML document. Okay. So this is the way of passing the XML document in DOM way. So let's go to the next parser. It is the sex parser. People say this as a event-based parser. The reason to do that is, once you ask this code to pass the XML document, it doesn't stop until it finds the crossing tag of root element. So you cannot say that only pass this chunk of the document, only pass that chunk of the document. Once you start this thing, it will fire few events, what we call callbacks. Okay, when you find the start element, it will call some method. When you find the end element, it will call some method. So we have to handle that in that. Okay, let's see how we can do that. So here, in the previous code, you had some document factory or something like that, right? Here we have sex parser factory. Okay, so each API, each way of doing these things, will have their own factory. Factory is it's a software engineering term, which is actually a design pattern. Okay, that is why they use this term for API. That is a standard way of getting object out of some shape. So here you instantiate the parser, which is a sex parser. And then, as I said, when you find elements like every foot tag will have its starting and end tag, right? Corresponding end tag. Like that, you have name, I'm writing here because I don't know if you can catch it. Okay. So likewise, you have all these things. What sex parser does is, once you ask it to pass, when it finds the start element, it will say, okay, I found the start element. What do you want to do with that? Like here also, I found the start element. What do you want to do with that? Here, it will say, okay, I found the end element. Now what should I do? Like that. Okay. So here you can see, in this, you have to write something called handler to handle this document. So it will say that I found this, I found that, I found that. So you have to handle that. Okay, that's why the term called handle. So within the handler, you have to write few methods which is predefined. Okay. You can override these methods. Okay. Here we are using some terms coming from object-oriented language programming. So I hope you guys can understand the things. If not, just talk. Okay. So there's a method called start element. All these parameters are predefined. Okay. So when you find the start element, it will pass all these things. this is coming from the API. This is the only part you have to write. Okay, you have to say that if you find this thing, do that. If you find that thing, do that, like that. Okay. So here you can see what I'm doing is, when I find the start element of name, okay, I'm doing something. You will find why I'm doing this in the next method. Okay. So if I when I find price, I know that there's some attribute for the price. Okay. So then I get the attribute. So here you can see, now I cannot say that give this element, give that element, give like that. It will give me the element, I have to handle it. I cannot control that. Okay. Do you see the difference between two APIs? Kind of. Okay. Here likewise, for all my all these tags, I have the, this if statement inside the start element tag. So likewise, the sex parser will fire end element method also. Yeah, when it finds the end of the tag. So actually, I'm not doing anything there. If I want to, I can. Okay. The next thing is the characters method, where it gives all the data. So when it finds the name tag, you remember I set the boolean variable to true. Okay. This is where I use the variable. Okay. If it is a name tag, what I do is get the string and print as name. Okay. So likewise, name, price, description, all these things, when it finds the data of that element, it will fire this method. Okay. So because these things are fired from the API, so these things are called as callbacks. Okay. I'm not calling this method. In this program, you will not find where I'm saying that dot end element, the method dot characters, dot that, like that. So I'm not calling this method. These methods are called by the parser. So only thing that I do here is, I'm saying the parser that I initialize just pass this element, this document, and I'm passing the handler where I define how to pass this document, how to pass each and everything, start element, character, and end element. Okay. So once I do that, it will pass the XML element, XML document, and it will do the rest. So let me run DOM parser and the sex parser. Okay. So you remember we had this document. This is the document we are trying to pass through our Java API. Data out of the elements, even the attributes. Okay. So this is the purpose of having the parsers. Okay. If you go back to the code here, you can see here I have price, description, name, and calories like that. So all the five food things, food elements are being passed like this. So I can get the data, given the attribute and whatever it is in the XML document, you can get it.
You can put this in any order you want.
Yeah, sure. Let's do that in SAS fast. Okay. Basically the same thing. You can get the all the data and element in the, and the attributes from the XML document. But two different ways of doing this. One is by using the tree structure, and other one is the event structure. The basic difference between when you are trying to pass the XML document, the main reason to go for a DOM or the SACS is DOM is memory consuming, because it will load the XML document, all XML document into a memory, and then it will go through all the tags. But here it's not the case. It will read the XML document. It doesn't want to load the whole document into the memory. It read, when it find the start, it will say, okay, I find the start. When it find end, I found the end tag, like that. So you have to just pass. So whenever you are dealing with big XML document, it's not a good practice to go with DOM. Okay, if you understand the basic difference between SACS and the DOM, you will understand that next one is somewhere in between. Okay. Let's see how it is written down. So here also I have to define the previous things I had the factory. Here also I have the same thing. Okay. And then what I can do is I'm not going to do it like a tree structure. What I'm doing is, if you have next, I'm asking from the API, if you have next, I will process the next. In the SACS parser, you don't have this option. You cannot ask whether you have the next, whether you don't, or whatever it is. It will just pass. Here you can see I can pass the elements in much more controlled manner. I have the control ability of go for the next or not. So what I'm doing is I load the XML document into this object, and I will ask if it has next. I go to the this method. What it does is, it will get the next element. Okay. It will get the next element, and it will give you some code saying that this is this type of thing, this is that type of thing, like that. Okay. If it is one, you know that start element. If it is two, you know that's the end element. Like that, these numbers are being defined in the API. Okay. So what? Basically here, start element, if I know it's 1, then I say it's a start element, and I can get the node name, okay. And I'm checking whether you have attributes or not, okay. So because I don't know whether this is the price element or the name element, what it does say is, it's a start element, then I have to say, I have to check whether you have the attribute. If I know it here, that this is the price, then I can say get the first attribute, which is the unit. But I cannot do it here because I don't have the control here. So likewise, it has this numbers, magic numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4. Like 1 is the start, n is the 2 is the end, 3 is the processing instruction, and 4 is basically the data. Okay. So in the DOM parser, you have to say that go to next, give me thing, give me this thing, and you have the counter. You can skip the things. In the SACS parser, You don't have that, it will tell you that I found the start, I found the end, and all these things. In here, it will tell you that I found this thing, but you have the controllability of going through the document. If you have next, you mean next. Like that. So this is somewhere in between the sets and the DOM parser. I don't know how this is being used in the industry, but I know that these two things are heavily used in the industry. So I will be uploading these code samples and slides and all those things into your group. And what you can do is, you can go to the, if you are familiar with Java APIs, you can go to the Java APIs and have a look what are the methods available, how can I write this code in a much more different way, like that. Or you can change this code and run it yourself and see what happens. Okay. Hopefully you will understand things from this code. So here are the comparison of different parsers. Okay. These are the attributes. API type, this is pull, means you ask for the elements. Okay. This is push, you don't ask, but it push you. Sex will push these elements to you. Okay. But here it's the other way. This is also the some kind of pull, okay, but this is the standard table that I got from some IBM site. And this is, we call it in memory tree, because it loads the XML document as a tree to your memory, and process it. And ease of use, maybe it is subjective, I may be more comfortable with SACS than the that is a subject. I don't know how to address that. And then the XPath. Okay, we will learn this XPath in the next class. Okay, XPath, XSL, and HSD. Okay, so, and this memory usage. Okay, various means the size of the document matters. Okay, if it is a small document, without any problem, you can deal with it. Okay, forward only means you cannot get the previous element when you pass through the XML document by using these two APIs. But here it is not the case. You can random access the elements. Not random access. You can say, give me this, give me that, like that. So basically, you can go back. So likewise, it has all these properties. They have document comparing all these things. So with this thing, next one is our XSL thing, which I am not going to start today. So basically, to summarize the things, we started with what is XML and how it's been used and what purposes, and then we move to how to write the XML document, where you have the different things like the elements, attributes, comments, processing instructions, and all those things. And we discuss why each and everything is there, like why the processing instruction is there, why the element, what's the difference between element and attribute kind of things. And then we move to well-formedness and validness of the document. You will understand well-formedness with this lecture, but you may need the validness of the validity of the XML document. You will understand it after the next lecture, where you cover the XSD, okay? Because you need to have that thing to understand that. And then we discuss how to pass the XML document, where you have all these three kind of APIs. And what's the what's the use of APIs? When you want to use the DOM versus SACS versus FACS like that, and we had this all the demo before. So what you can do is, I have the file. I will upload that also. The file, like XML file, sample file that I used, and these things you can play it. Okay. So even in your first assignment, you can. You basically you store some data there, right? Your name and you basically you're doing the form page. Okay? So your name and all these attributes. You can define those in the XML document and convert it to the HTML. Okay? So, okay. The next step is going to be XPath, XSL, and XSD. And then at the end of the next lecture, we will give you an assignment. Based on these two lectures, which will cover all these aspects. Okay? Any questions? Yes.
First, if we start struggling with the parsing part, is it okay if we contact you or is it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I want to know if we address our questions, if we have problems with them.
Okay. Okay, guys. See you on Tuesday.